Good morning and welcome to a session I have really been looking forward to. Our session title, Women Belong in All Places Where Nuclear Safety Decisions Are Being Made, is derived from a well-known quote from the late Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who said, "Women need to be in all places where decisions are made." This statement rings especially true in the nuclear safety arena, as the best safety decisions are made when the deliberations involve diverse and inclusive groups of professionals sharing a wide variety of views. Today, we're joined by the distinguished Rumina Velshi, the president of the Canadian Nuclear, president and chief executive officer, excuse me, of the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission since August of 2018. In addition to her day job as Canada's head nuclear regulator, she also serves as the chairperson of the International Atomic Energy Agency's Commission on Safety Standards. Her expertise in the energy industry encompasses technical, regulatory, and adjudication areas. Ms. Velshi was one of the first female nuclear energy workers in Canada and has worked in various capacities at Ontario Hydro and Ontario Power Generation. She also previously served as a board member of the Ontario Energy Board, the economic regulator of the province's electricity and natural gas sectors. President Velshi's reputation as a regulator of the highest order precedes her, and I'm honored to have her speak with us. In addition to her incredible work in various other areas, President Velshi has been a force for change on the international stage in the promotion of gender equity in the nuclear field. In September of 2020, President Velshi, along with Canada's ambassador to the International Atomic Energy Agency and the IAEA's Director General, established the International Gender Champions Impact Group on Gender Equality in Nuclear Regulatory Agencies. The group seeks to identify and implement policies to recruit and retain women, promote a diverse workplace, and promote gender parity on international panels and delegations. I have former chairperson Christine Savinicki to thank for answering President Velshi's call to action and accepting the invitation to join the International Gender Champions Impact Group. And it's my great honor and privilege to continue this important work. Promotion of gender equity plays a key role in the future that I envision for the NRC. And it's my absolute pleasure to help set the stage for a conversation between President Velshi and our very own Brooke Poole Clark, the newly designated Secretary of the Commission. Ms. Clark previously served as the NRC's Deputy General Counsel for Licensing, Hearing, and Enforcement. She also previously served as the Director in the Office of Commission Appellate Adjudication, where she was responsible for preparing recommendations and adjudicatory opinions for the Commission in support of its quasi-judicial function. In addition to her new role as Secretary of the Commission, I'm excited to announce that Ms. Clark will be serving as the NRC's Gender Champion, providing executive-level oversight of the agency's participation in international gender-related activities, and to champion good practices and lessons learned related to promoting diversity and gender balance in the NRC workforce. In her role as Secretary of the Commission, Ms. Clark will be taking over for the illustrious, the amazing, indeed the legendary, Annette Vietti Cook. No pressure, Brooke. And I'd like to take just a quick moment to acknowledge the contributions Annette Vietti Cook has made to our agency's important mission. Annette, you've made an incredible, incredible impact on the NRC. And I'm so very grateful for your many years of service to the agency, and so grateful that our paths crossed. With that, let's begin.
Thank you so much, Chairman Hanson. Again, welcome, President Velshi. It's so exciting to have you here with us today. I was fortunate enough to hear you speak in person 3 years ago at our Federal Women's Program Advisory Committee luncheon, which also took place during the RIC. You spoke then in a very powerful way about gender balance in terms of candlelight. When we use one candle's flame to ignite another, the original flame does not diminish, but instead there is twice as much light. The more light that is shared, the brighter the room becomes. We've had 3 years since then to enlighten and be enlightened and to promote a sense of belonging in our workplaces. And we've come a long way, as can be seen in many examples. The fact that we're holding this special plenary session is one.
Brooke, I couldn't agree more with you. So first of all, thank you so much, Chairman Hanson and the USNRC for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to talk about something that is very near and dear to me. So yes, lots has changed for the better over the past 3 years, certainly when it comes to gender equity in the nuclear sector. And Brooke, as you said, this session is really, it exemplifies the change in my mind. 3 years ago, it was a side event. It was, you know, part of the Women's History Month. And we had, you know, a fairly decent attendance, 150 or so people, a few dozen men in there. But look at it 3 years later. One, it is now I'm sharing the stage with Chairman Hanson, which to me shows a couple of things, the need for visible leadership, and also that this is not a women's issue. This is a societal issue that requires everyone to be part of the solution. So Chairman Hanson, I thank you for your visible leadership. The second one is that this is no longer a side event. This is part of the plenary. It's part of our core business. And again, a great recognition of that. And thirdly, Brooke, congratulations on this new role that you have taken on, because this cannot be done from the corner of someone's desk. This requires attention, it requires oversight, it requires resources to make real progress. And so I think just this one session and some of those examples is an indication to me on how far we have come. But perhaps maybe to set the stage for our conversation, Brooke, I'd like to share a short video with the audience. This is an initiative that was launched in the Canadian nuclear sector, one that the regulator was a catalyst on how do we drive the advancement of women in nuclear. So it's called Dawn. And maybe what I'll do is get you to show the video and then pick from there on why we have launched it and what are some of our aspirations and challenges that go with that. So maybe if we can roll the video, please. Dawn heralds a new beginning, a new light, a new awareness. It's an apt name for our organization. We are motivated by a vision of real change. We recognize the importance of gender equity. We are driving the advancement of women in nuclear. The nuclear industry depends on people who are committed to learning, focused, and curious. Traits common to both men and women, and yet women make up less than 25% of our industry's workforce. We need an environment where all skilled and talented workers can achieve their potential. An environment that welcomes broad perspectives and fresh energy, accelerating innovation and enhancing safety and productivity. Progress has been made, but there is still much to do. Dawn is taking action now to close the gaps. We inspire women to thrive, to seek opportunities, and take risks. We help remove the barriers to advancement, enabling a healthy balance between the demands of senior positions and personal responsibilities. We welcome male allies to join us in promoting inclusion and diversity. These influential, experienced voices swell the ranks of industry stakeholders who support the goal of gender equality in the nuclear sector. This is a time of change, and like the break of dawn, women are lighting up the future of nuclear. Leading by example, rising to our true potential, making the world a better place. Learn more. Get involved. Take your place. And make a difference. So I hope you found that video inspirational. And it's an example of how the entire sector has come together to address this very, very critical area of importance to all of us. And, you know, yesterday was International Women's Day, and I watched what was happening in the Canadian nuclear sector, how the day was getting commemorated, the celebration of the contributions of women, and a recommitment to where we really need to get to. Brooke, maybe I'll turn it over to you and we can maybe pick on a few threads from here.
Wonderful. Well, President Velshi, among many other things, you've taken a leadership role to look at issues impacting gender equity in a global context. To name just one effort, although a significant one, you are the co-chair of the International Gender Champions Impact Group, as Chairman Hanson mentioned, which aims to take collective actions to advance gender equity in the nuclear regulatory community. Can you tell us more about your work in the Impact Group and other international initiatives that you're working on, and why are they important to us as regulators?
So maybe let me just start off with, why is gender equity important? Important to me, to society, to us as regulators. And some of this really doesn't need much saying. I mean, I think we'll all agree that it's kind of the right moral thing to do. There is just a plethora of evidence that this is a smart thing to do. It's good for the bottom line. It's good for productivity. It's good for innovation. And we heard from Chairman Hanson how important it is to have diverse perspectives around the table, that for us as regulators, we want to make sure that there isn't groupthink, that there is an environment that welcomes different viewpoints, that challenges the status quo, and that ultimately leads to better, safer outcomes. And when we improve the working life for women, we actually improve it for everyone in our workplace. And frankly, for us, our public expects us, you know, when we talk about the need for enhanced trust and confidence of the public in the regulator, they want to look towards us to say, we reflected in your makeup and how you make your decisions. And so I think it's very important from that perspective as well. And so it was, and regulators play, I believe, a very special role, because we have the opportunity, the platform to influence the entire sector. In the Canadian context, soon after I took on my role, it was very common at all our public hearings and proceedings that I would ask our licensees, so how are you managing your talent? What's the representation of women? How are you changing that? What does your board look like? And now they all come prepared with those answers, and they have got some really firm, concrete plans. And so I think, as you saw with the Dawn video, the regulator can actually multiply, actually exponentially grow the impact that we have. And so it was kind of with that in mind that we thought, well, having this International Gender Champion Group, so these are diplomats that get together on driving gender equity, and I was asked if it would make sense to do that for the nuclear regulators. And we started off, there were seven of us. Chairman Svinicki was one of the founding partners in this. And we have Director General Grossi from the IAEA and Director General Magwood from the OECD's NEA, both the strongest male allies for gender equity that I have seen. And over the year and a half, we've now grown to almost 30 members. And our key objective, one is each member has to make a pledge that they are committed to striving for gender equity, that we agree to share best practices with each other. And we're putting a compendium of these best practices. And really, at our last meeting, we agreed that we need to develop a framework of metrics, of indicators, both qualitative and quantitative, that would allow us to measure how we're doing, to track progress, to aggregate and synthesize and do a bit of comparison, et cetera. And so we're making progress. And perhaps if you give me a minute, Brooke, I'd like to share a couple of best practices that have been shared. One is by the United Arab Emirates regulator, FENAR. I think the UAE puts the rest of us to shame in how much advancement they have made in gender equity for a new nuclear comer. they have pretty much got to equity, and they also have a very strong pipeline. So, you know, you heard in the Dawn video, in Canada, we're at about 25%, which is pretty much the same across the globe generally. But what's also of greater concern to me is that when we look at our universities and enrollment in STEM programs, it's still in the mid 20%. So if we just left it to time to take care of things, it won't. And what FENAR, what the UAE has done is there, more than 50% of their STEM students are women, is how they have driven this culture, this policy direction on how we need greater equity, how we need greater diversity. You actually see that from the moment you arrive at the airport with the posters and their messaging. And so that was shared with us. One that Canada shared, one that I'm really proud of, is we have a tool called GBA Plus, gender-based analysis. And the plus is that we started with gender, but now go through all other kind of designated groups, whether it is persons with disability, persons of color, indigenous community members, et cetera. And it's a tool that forces us to take a lens to all our programs, all our processes, all our policies, and see, have we addressed any unique needs that may exist for these folks? And we have found, much to our chagrin, certainly even in our regulatory framework, where we have introduced systemic biases unbeknownst to us that have actually precluded women from participating fully in our sector. And so I think that GBA Plus is a great tool. So the International Gender Champion Impact Group, a great forum for regulators to get together. And in the audience, if there are nuclear regulators who have not signed up for it, I strongly encourage you to do so. Reach out to me and we will embrace you with both arms. The second one that I want to, and I don't want to steal the thunder from DG Megwood, but the OECD's NEA has been doing phenomenal work when it comes to gender equity. And right now they're in the midst of putting together a pretty comprehensive policy framework that they're hoping that OECD countries would adopt. And it looks at attraction, retention, and advancement of women in the nuclear sector. I've been part of their advisory committee on this. And again, I think it requires us addressing this issue at many levels from all fronts in a very collaborative way for us to make real lasting difference. And so I'm really happy with really the great progress that has happened in the last little while.
You talked about barriers. We'll definitely come back to that. But let's talk a little bit about the pipeline, which you also mentioned. Here at the NRC, we're continuing to restructure our workforce to support our mission. And as a result of our strategic workforce planning process, we anticipate a considerable increase in external hires to replace the loss of staff in critical positions. Many of these are STEM positions. To build our pipeline, we do much of this through entry-level hiring, including our recently refreshed nuclear regulator apprenticeship network. And I have to mention, near to my heart, the Honor Law Graduate Program for attorneys. We also feed our pipeline through our newly reestablished University Nuclear Leadership Program. These and other programs support our efforts to recruit a diverse, high-qualified workforce designed to support the agency's needs in our transformative environment. Our recruitment activities will help to develop a diverse candidate pipeline. As you note, they include a focus not only on women, but also minorities, veterans, individuals with disabilities. Where do you think the nuclear sector, and you've given a few examples, but where do you think the nuclear sector, including the regulators, have done well? And how do you think our recruitment efforts can be better focused?
So I think some of the things that you have talked about, what the USNRC is doing, and I applaud you for that, because I think those are some of the best practices that are out there. You know, our demographics sucks, probably similar to yours. We have many folks who are close to retirement age, and the labor market is very competitive. And for us, at the sector level, it is difficult for the regulator to compete with industry when it comes to compensation. However, our mandate is phenomenal. So that's what attracts people. It's people who really want to join public service and make a difference. So the mandate helps. But the other big part is are our working conditions and what kind of a work environment and what kind of expertise and the kind of people that exist at the work, because that is also a magnet to bring in the top talent that we want to. So we have, with my leadership team, we have increased our presence and our profile at the various different universities to talk about not only what we do, but what is the culture in our organization and the kinds of values that we uphold. We have, with a great deal of engagement of our staff, come up with hiring goals. I truly believe that you've got to set goals, you've got to have a roadmap, you've got to measure, you've got to be held accountable to those things. And we have set those hiring goals for those different groups, and using the labor market availability to try to normalize our goals. And we're very transparent about it. And as I said, we've done it in a very inclusive way. And one of the benefits from the pandemic that has come about is it has, for just everyone around the world, has shown how effective we can be in a hybrid work environment. And this has allowed us to extend our talent pool, whereas it would be in the national capital region in Canada for the most part, to really truly make it national. And so over the last couple of years, we've been hiring people from across the country, and that increased talent pool has really helped. I think our hiring process is very similar to yours. We've tried to make sure that we try to exclude any systemic biases, that we've got panels that are representatives, so that we don't all hire in our own mode, so to speak. And some of the other interesting things that I have seen, and some that you've talked about, there are co-op programs, internship programs, guaranteeing a job if you meet the requirements. And something that I know that some of our licensees, folks in the industry do, is sometimes they will make funding that they make available to universities, for instance, conditional on that there is at least an X percentage of students that are, different minorities. So I think what we're seeing is, again, a multifaceted approach, and we're seeing progress.
Excellent. So once we've recruited the top talent, we have to focus on retention and avenues for progression. At the NRC, for example, we've done a variety of things and we continue to work on it. One example is the commission approved changes last year to the resident inspector program to help recruit and retain highly qualified residents and senior residents. More broadly, our Chief Human Capital Office has created an employee journey platform that provides opportunities for staff to explore career paths at the agency. Another area of focus and really keen interest is elimination and identification first, and elimination of barriers to horizontal and vertical movement that we may have inadvertently created over time. One example is classifying positions, a uniquely governmental, bureaucratic thing, but we classify positions in certain employment series. We may now find, though, that we can be more fluid in the series. For example, a branch chief in a technical office in the past maybe had an educational requirement as a scientist or an engineer. Maybe that position can be reclassified to allow for a greater diversity of candidates who've learned on the job. Even in OGC, we've made an effort to change prerequisites for some of our non-lawyer jobs to allow training on the job so that folks can move between employment series and find ladders for progression. And as a result, we're seeing improvements in gender balance. To give you just one example, we've increased our percentage of women in the senior executive corps a little bit, from 28% to 38% over the past 5 years, and in diversity writ large. So we have seen some good improvements, and we're on the right track. But where do you still see barriers to women and others, whether horizontal or vertically? Do you feel like unconscious bias plays a role in there? And how do you think we can squarely address these barriers?
So again, my compliments to the great work that's happening at the USNRC. And I can't take much credit for this at all, but even at the CNSC, we're pretty much at parity at all levels. So even on my senior leadership team, of the six of us, three are women. Further down as we go into the organization. So where are some of the barriers? I think some of them are fairly fundamental. It's even working conditions and something we actually just stumbled on in the last little while. You know, a sister regulator of ours, the Canadian Energy Regulator, found that some of their inspectors, when they're out in remote work environments, have to put up with working conditions that are simply unacceptable. And when they shared those with us, we said, you know, we've really never found out from our, you know, it's fine with the large nuclear facilities. There are no issues. These are very enlightened employers with very strong zero tolerance harassment policies and programs. But for the more remote, small operators, industrial applications, what are some of the barriers that our inspectors encounter? And we found that it's really tough. It's anything from intimidating comments to pornography pasted in the workplace to, you know, hard hats that have got all kinds of suggestive comments on that. Just to make life uncomfortable and again, conveying the message that you don't belong here. And so we have, along with our other regulators, established this WIRE, you know, Women in Regulatory Enforcement, come together and see how can we make the workplace more conducive? How do we make sure we let our licensees know what our expectations are? Because when our inspectors are there, that's an extension of the workplace. But, you know, to your point around the systemic biases that that get introduced, and I'm going to share something with you because it was just shared with me very recently. We do, as I'm sure you do, we do semi-annual reviews of our talent pool, and certainly those for leadership positions. And at our last meeting, our HR person had come and, you know, given us a refresher around unconscious bias. You know, it's mandatory training for all of us, but again, more of a reminder that as you're reviewing this candidate, you know, be aware and, you know, listen to it, call it out when you hear it. And I was sharing this with a colleague of mine, and she says, you know, we this week are going through that same exercise. You know, it's an international company. She's a general manager of one line of business. And I'll share with you what happens at our forum, because they too have gone through this unconscious bias training. And she shared with me a screenshot. And these were the adjectives that were used to describe the 24 or so women in that senior leadership pool. And I want to share these with you. Shrill, bossy, hysterical, ice queen, moody, high maintenance, feisty, pushy, aggressive. And I think most of us have heard that before. And only to say that this was said, you know, these gendered bias terms without anyone calling it out. And I think some of this is so insidious in our workplaces that we almost become oblivious to it. And every now and then we need to get shaken up and saying, watch out, look out, and be aware. So I wouldn't want us to even for a moment think that we don't have challenges that need to be addressed.
Thank you. Well, finally, you've spoken previously about all this mindfulness, and this all goes back to early childhood. An example that you've given in the past that really stuck in my mind was the example of a teacher in a primary school, maybe kindergarten, giving boys a robot picture to color, but giving girls a clown. As the regulators, I think we are looking for opportunities where we can educate and excite student populations about regulatory careers and about STEM careers. Our efforts are focused in the main at the university level. We have university champions, the co-op program, internships, as you've discussed. These efforts help bring students, you know, to our agencies and to the nuclear sector to experience the work. How do we better focus on youth education from childhood all the way through to university?
So again, this is, I think it's fundamental that we address it right at the early stages of building that pipeline. And, you know, research has shown that for some reason, when girls get to their early teenage years, suddenly something switches in their brain and science and math is not quite as attractive as it used to be. And then they opt out for from STEM programs. And so that it's grade eight, but it's like the 12 to 14 year olds, to me, is that critical age that some intervention is required. What we're doing at the CNSE, as an example, you know, we have a Women in STEM initiative. I have a gender champion like you, Brooke, in my organization that running a whole lot of great programs. And one of them is our outreach program, where we want to reach out to younger students, boys and girls, to talk about STEM careers, but really to be role models. What has become very evident is the importance of role models, that if I can see her, I can be her. And we need to have that greater visibility by our younger engineers and scientists. And the NEA has got these mentoring workshops that they hold for young girls. I have been a mentor and co-chair for many of their sessions. Again, extremely successful, but I think it needs to start at a young age. And you know, that example of the clown and the robot is classic, because the teacher probably thought, oh, at least I didn't give her a doll to color, right? And that's progress, but yeah, we've got a ways to go, but we've got some good things happening as well.
Well, thank you so much, President Velshi. Looks like we have a little bit of time to take some questions. Well, I have some for you. I have a couple that will also include Chairman Hanson. I think I'd start off, you know, we're hopefully coming out of the COVID pandemic a little bit and returning to our new normal in the workplace, a hybrid workplace. And you talked about this and the benefits that we've realized from hybrid work. Here's a question for you both. There has been a change in how management views telework as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. Many organizations, including both of ours, have implemented new workplace flexibility guidelines. How do you think these new guidelines will impact the advancement of women?
Should I go first?
Sure.
Last word then, Chairman Hanson. So I think for our organization and just overall, I think it's a very, very positive move to provide this greater flexibility, especially for women, but you know, everyone benefits. And my organization has really tried to maximize the flexibility, let the teams decide how often they need to come into the office. And so not only has it increased the talent pool, I think that flexibility allows greater work-life balance. And again, from the pandemic, we've heard some horrendous numbers, like 40% of the women want to leave the workforce. We're not seeing that in ours. And I think that flexibility goes a long way. The other thing that has come out from the pandemic that I just want to highlight is the different leadership styles that have been appreciated a lot more. And certainly the empathy angle has been such a critical part of helping us become resilient and get through it. And these tend to be kind of the more softer side of leadership skills. Women sometimes have an advantage at that. And I think more importantly than the advantage, I have seen even in my organization, just a greater confidence amongst the women leaders on how supportive they can be for their folks and how they can help bring out the best in their staff. So I think all this bodes very well.
Absolutely. So a couple thoughts, and I want to pick up on, I think, a couple of themes that President Velshi mentioned, right? The COVID pandemic provided an opportunity to kind of reset how we think about work. And I think maybe before the pandemic, there was a bit of a career penalty associated with telework. And the sincere hope on my part is that with the pandemic and the pervasiveness now of telework, that penalty's gone away. And we have to be careful as we move into these new modes of working together, we don't kind of unconsciously kind of reinstitute that. And so there really is a kind of an an opening here for more creativity about how to work together. And to pick up on a theme, I think that President Velshi mentioned, the notion of presence and intentionality in online and hybrid work really takes on a greater importance. And that there is, I hope, more appetite for a bigger diversity of management styles kind of going forward. So I'm really optimistic and hopeful that some of the changes that we're going to be grappling with going forward provide more opportunities for women participation and women leadership in the workforce.
Thank you both. Here's a question for President Velshi. In your opening remarks, President Velshi, you mentioned that gender equity is a problem for society as a whole, not just a women's issue. Could you expand on that? How do we bring more allies into the fold?
Thank you for that question. You know, one of the biggest challenges that we face with what we're trying to achieve is that some folks think this is a zero-sum game, that if women were to advance, it's at the expense of men. And so, Brooke, I really appreciated in your opening comments where you talked about my candlelight analogy. And what we have found is when you have men joining, of course, as you saw in the video too, you've just got that much more momentum that's being built. And we are really preparing our work environments for the future, where we want to make sure that our workplaces are welcoming of everyone, that there's a sense of belonging, and that we enable and empower everyone to reach their true potential. And so men need to be part of that. This is, as I said, it's not a women's issue only. It makes everyone's lives better, and we are all brothers and fathers and husbands. And so there is also that personal interest in this. When if it's just seen by women, it's just put in as a side issue that needs to be handled by women. This is really for society to benefit. And as I said, the results have shown it is society that benefits from greater involvement of women.
Another one for you, President Velshi, and this question I think is a really critical one. As a woman in nuclear, I often find I have to work 10 times as hard as my male counterparts to gain and maintain my credibility, and I am judged far more harshly for minor mistakes or errors than my male peers are. At times, I feel my contributions are ignored in favor of a male perspective or credit is given to males over me. In environments such as these, it is difficult not only to stand out from my peers, but to remain competitive for advancement in my own career. What advice would you give women who face barriers to advancement as a result of conscious or unconscious bias in the workplace?
I hear that question often, sadly. I still hear that. And it is the reality for many. I too have encountered that. I'm happy to say I don't as much now, but I certainly have in my career. And so in our Dawn video, the first theme that we picked on was around the confidence gap, because that just erodes one's confidence, that if every time you say something and then someone speaks over you and you know, someone says, oh, what a great idea when he said it, as opposed to you said it, and you go, ooh, did I not make myself clear? Did I not convey it? And it's always looking inwards to say, what could I have done better, as opposed to, frankly, it was probably not you at all. And so mine is, one is, you know, don't be harsh on yourself, got to be kind on yourself. But this is where allyship comes in, that people can't be bystanders. If any one of us hears that, men or women in a meeting where someone talks over someone or someone kind of picks someone's idea and presents it as their own, it behooves the rest of us to speak up about it. And I was at an International Women's Day event yesterday where I was speaking, and one of the questions I got, it's kind of in a similar vein, but I want to share that with you because it was a very painful question to me, where a woman said, you know, she often, and other women often hear in meetings, well, if you just smiled, he will do it. How do I respond to that? And again, the message being that all a woman has to do is look pretty and be nice, and that's all that she can actually do. That's all that's expected of her. And it just erodes our self-worth and our confidence immensely. I don't think anyone appreciates the price we pay for that. And to the men, it may be, but I paid her a compliment. Well, it's not a compliment, buddy. It isn't. So again, I think it's so important that when we do, you know, it's these microaggressions, that when we speak about these at different fora, that we come forth with those kinds of concerns, give our side of it, and let people appreciate what this is doing to us and the impact that it does. It's those paper cuts, right? And over time, suddenly you go, I can't take this anymore. I'm out of this. And you've got to prevent that. It is a real issue. And it requires all of us to address that.
And one, I think we have time for one more question before I turn it over to Chairman Hanson. And this is a question for both of you. What are some of the ways that the leaders and regulatory agencies with strong female representation can influence or other organizations in the nuclear sector with lower female representation, especially when little change to those numbers has been seen over a period of years?
Let you go first, Chairman Hanson.
Except that I'm on mute, like everyone at some point in this pandemic. So, what can we do? I think that's a great question. So, you know, when I talk inside the agency, I talk about diversity inclusion and its importance and the importance of women in the agency. But I try not to just do it when I'm talking to NRC employees. I actually try to do it when I'm actually out talking to industry groups as well. So when I go talk to the nuclear strategy industry, whatever it is, NSIAC, at the U.S., part of the U.S. Nuclear Energy Institute, I also talk about the importance of diversity and inclusion. And that prompts them oftentimes to then turn around and tell me what it is that they're doing as well. And so I think sometimes having that outside the agency, having people know that that's a priority for the NRC and for me personally, I kind of I have some hope, hopefully not Pollyannish, but some hope that that makes a difference.
And I, you know, maybe just to build on what Chairman Hanson has said, I have been, frankly, quite aggressive about this. Even before I started this role, I made it known that this was of critical importance to me as we build our talent and as we look for a more safer outcomes. So I do the same when I meet with industry, when I meet with the boards of directors, when they appear in front of us at the commission, I will ask, I will challenge. And maybe I'll just give one example on the difference it does make at a very working level. We had at a license renewal hearing, one of the employees from one of our uranium mines, who's a jet bore system operator, the first woman in the world, maybe the only woman in the world. And she was, you know, there to talk about that great culture they have in the organization, the support of their leadership and so on. And I asked her, I said, if there was one thing that your management can do to make your workplace more conducive, what would it be? And her answer was, a women's washroom underground would be kind of nice. And I went, oh my God, I fought that 40 years ago. And today we still, you know, some fairly basic things are not available. And, but here's the difference today compared to when I had to struggle with this 40 years ago. The very next day, we got the licensee's commitment that work was underway to build the washroom. And yesterday I was speaking to that particular employer, and you know, it was the—I wouldn't say it was at the regulators nudging. They probably realized this is the right thing to do. I think we can make a huge difference as the regulator, yeah, and we should exercise that.
Thank you. That's a great note on which to end. Thank you so much, President Velshi. Chairman Hanson, I turn it over to you for closing remarks.
Thanks, Brooke, and thanks to you both for what has really been an incredible conversation. I could sit and listen to you both talk all day long, even though I think as you both really kind of brought to the fore and amply indicated that listening is not sufficient, right? There's a lot of work to do and we need to get to it. I'm glad we're doing this the day after International Women's Day. International Women's Day, I think, is a really important event globally to highlight these issues. But it's just one day. And I think what really matters is what we do the next day and the day after that. So I was glad. At first, I thought, oh, we should be doing this on the 8th. No. I think today is actually the perfect day. And in fact, every day is the perfect day for an event and in a conversation like this. There are so many themes to pick up on. I'll just bring one. I loved, Rumina, your kind of word association a little bit, and it reminded me to be really careful about the B word in the workplace, and that B word is bossy. And bossy is just fine, because that's oftentimes how things get done. And so forth. Before we go, I know it's 11:30. I want to put in a plug for the event this afternoon. There's a session this afternoon. The Federal Women's Program Advisory Committee here at the NRC, as well as our Office of International Programs, will jointly host a panel called "Making a Global Impact: Women in International Nuclear Policy," to highlight the roles that women are playing in international nuclear policy and engagement activities. They have an incredible lineup, including some of my favorite people. Margie Doan and Joyce Connery are on that panel. And I think it promises to be a fantastic event, and I hope you will all return and join us then. Thank you both so very much.